This Fast Graphs demo number 3 will look at the Fast Graphs forecasting tools. There are basically two Fast Graph forecasting tools. The first is the Estimated Earnings and Return Calculator. And the second is the 10-year Earnings Yield Estimator. When initially drawn, both of these tools default to and are therefore driven by the consensus of leading analysts, in most cases reporting to First Call, but in some cases, Zacks will also be included. All the subscriber needs to do is type in the stock symbol and hit the Go button, and the Fast Graphs will automatically be drawn. It's important that the Fast Graph subscriber understands that these are estimated earnings and return calculators and tools that simply are doing calculations based on these analyst estimates. As you'll see a little later in the demo, there is an override function where the subscriber can add their own estimates if they disagree with the consensus estimates. Let's start by looking at the estimated earnings and return calculator and its various components and how to use them. First of all, when the symbol is then put into the ticker symbol box and the Go button is hit, the estimated earnings and return calculator draws an orange earnings justified valuation line that is drawn based on using a modified version of Ben Graham's formula. We calculate a 15 multiple, and so this orange earnings justified valuation line represents a PE ratio of 15, and that's referenced and marked to the right of the graph. Directly below and directly above the graph are four additional orange lines that are parallel to the first line that represent the exact same growth rate of 8.3%. In other words, all lines on this graph are sloped the same. However, as parallel lines, these would represent different valuation points on the graph. These five orange lines collectively represent what we like to refer to as a corridor of value. The idea behind a forecasting graph is recognizing it's not going to give precise and perfect numbers. We try to develop a range of reasonableness that the subscriber can use based on looking at any individual company they choose to analyze. In other words, if the stock price falls anywhere between these orange lines, it would theoretically be in value. On the dark orange line would represent fair value. The two below lines would represent below fair value, and of course the two lines would represent high fair value or full fair value. Once the stock price deviates out of that corridor, it would indicate either high overvaluation or very excessive undervaluation accordingly. Each of these lines has a corresponding PE ratio attached to it. So in other words, if you were looking at the top blue line on this graph on Abbott Labs, that would represent a price earnings ratio of 22.5. So if the stock price were touching this blue line, it would be trading at 22.5. As you can see, it's just above the second light-colored orange line below the dark orange line, which represents a PE of 12, and the current PE is 12.4, which you can measure just by simply looking at this line and going to the scale to the right. Based on what we see here with Abbott Labs, if it does grow at 8.3%, and the stock is worth 15 times earnings, what we're saying is that if the consensus was right and the earnings growth turned out to be $6.82 by year-end calendar year 2016, then Abbott Labs would theoretically be worth $102.35, or 15 times this earnings estimate. That would translate into a 5-year estimated total return of 14.6%, which includes dividends. Since Abbott Labs does pay a dividend, the estimated dividends are shaded in the light blue area above the graph, and they're indicated being paid out of the green shaded area, which represents earnings, just like it does on the historical Fast Graphs. And of course, to the right of the estimated earnings and return calculator, you see some basic data. For example, current price, the day, this is the previous day's close, the current price earnings ratio, the actual estimated earnings growth rate based on the consensus of these 19 analysts. A snapshot of the balance sheet shows that, in this case, Abbott Labs has 36% debt, and then it trades on the New York Stock Exchange. Recognizing that the Fast Graph is a dynamic tool, by simply pointing your cursor at any one of these points, a pop-up window with the date and price will show up. So, for example, the subscriber could say, assuming that this level of earnings growth actually occurred, and the market decided to put a 22 multiple on the stock by year-end 2016, which is very close to their historical multiple, that would imply $153.52 stock price by 12/31. Therefore, the subscriber can look at these different valuations to determine what they think the risk-reward ratio of owning this stock, assuming the estimates are correct. The earnings estimates are listed at the bottom of the graph for each respective year, as well as any estimates of dividend that correlate with the growth rate. So in other words, this is simply compounding the dividend at the expected 8.3% growth rate, always remembering that this is a calculator tool. In the case where the subscriber disagrees with consensus estimates, they can simply go into this override button and apply their own number. I'm going to apply a 10% growth rate, which is the historical growth rate that this company has actually achieved. Then I'm going to simply hit the go button and redraw the graph. And now we've overridden this graph with a 10% growth rate. The price earnings ratio stays the same because it's below the 15% growth, which would put it into a PEG ratio, as we'll show in a moment. But you can see the calculations change. This would now imply a 15.8% rate of return, and you would see a higher price point based on 15 times earnings growing at this 10% rate. For illustration purposes, I'm going to override the 2012 dividend and increase it from $2.08 to $2.15. Then by simply hitting the go button, I would get the new dividend rate of 215 that I have now overridden into the graph. But also notice that since I did not redraw the 10% override, in this case, the graph automatically defaults back to the consensus. That way, the user can always know that they have the actual consensus numbers when they're drawing these graphs. By typing in a new symbol, I've added Apple here, and drawing the graph on Apple, the difference now is that we have a PEG ratio graph, because the estimated growth rate of 36 analysts are forecasting an 18% growth rate for Apple. So the forecast graph for Apple now is showing an 18% growth rate. Company has no debt and there are 36 analysts. If you felt that this number again was either over or under, once again, remember that you could go in and override this and add a bigger number, for example, if you chose, and you could add a 30% growth rate and see what it would look like at these higher numbers. You could also, of course, draw a 10% growth rate or what have you. Now I'm going to draw a chart on Medtronic, a company that does pay a dividend but a lower rate than Abbott. And we're going to segue then after we draw the Medtronic chart and look at the 10-year earnings yield estimator graph, which is the second of the forecasting graphs. What this does is actually looks at earning yield. And the idea here is that it calculates putting an equal investment into the company versus putting an equal investment into a 10-year treasury bond. The idea here is to look at the mathematics that are actually underpinning the fundamentals of the business relative to riskless investments. It's also a color-coded graph that allows you to have an instantaneous depiction of whether or not you're being compensated for the risk. Since Medtronic pays a much lower dividend yield than Abbott Labs did, the current dividend yield is only 2.1%, and that's less than a current rate on a 10-year treasury bond. The column marked dividends is automatically pink, and what this shows is that the dividend yield is less than what you could earn on a treasury bond, both cumulatively, as you can see by the total estimated dividends, as well as on each individual year. When the earnings are greater than the rate on the treasury bond, the earnings columns will be green, and the earnings yield will also be green. Since this particular company appears to be undervalued, you'll notice that its earnings yield of 8% is higher than the interest yield you could earn on a treasury bond. By going back to Abbott Labs, you can see that Abbott Labs with a current yield of 3.4% is higher than what you could earn on interest in a 10-year treasury bond. Therefore, the dividends per share column, the estimated dividends, and the dividend yield column are all blue. Now we have redrawn the chart for Apple Computer here, and since Apple doesn't pay dividends, you can see that the columns are pink, indicating that the dividend yields are obviously less than you can earn on a 10-year treasury bond. On the other hand, if I drew the estimated yield on Aflac, you'll see that because it pays 2.4% dividend yield, it's starting out less than the treasury bond, but based on what we call growth yield, or some call yield on cost, eventually the cumulative dividends cross over and actually equal more than you could earn on a 10-year treasury bond. And at that point, the columns will turn blue. This concludes our demo on the forecasting tools. Future tutorials and demos will go into more depth.